Today, we touch upon a topic that has been an area of great focus for us at Live History India, because we really believe it is time that we looked deeply and focused on the story of women through history. Let's be honest, history has done a terrible disservice to women, because it is really his story when you look back at the past. We know that women would have played an important role at any time in any part of society, but their stories have never really been chronicled, told, and we really have to sift through a lot of material to find the heroines from Indian history. So Live History India at the very start started a section called Her Story, where we consciously tried to look out for more women and kind of bring out their stories. And one of the authors I really enjoy reading is Ira Mukherjee, who's done a phenomenal job in looking at deep into archives and texts to bring out the stories of these women. She's written 4 books, of course. The 3rd was in Akbar. Again, he was a Renaissance man, so we accept him as, again, somebody who had so many great facets to admire. But Ira joins us today to talk about her latest book, Draupadi, and of course, the work that she has done across the genre, so to say. And it gives me great pleasure, Ira, to welcome you on the show today.
Thank you so much, Mini, and thank you for all the work that you do and the encouragement.
Ira, of course, you know, one of my favorite stories about you, and I remember sitting in Bengali market and eating chaat with you once, and you were telling me how you started on this quest. And I think it's a beautiful story, because most people don't realize that you're actually, you started thinking about writing about women at a time when you were doing pure sciences at your master's at Cambridge. And you had 2 daughters, and you decided that, you know, you must start looking at this. Please tell us how you ventured into this space.
Yes, thank you, Mini. So yes, it's a slightly longer tale than that, but you're right in that, you know, when I was growing up and I was studying, and I was always very interested in literature and writing and creative writing. But, you know, in my generation, when if you were a vaguely capable student, you were encouraged to go into the arts and into the sciences, because the humanities and the arts were not considered serious subjects. So I stumbled into the sciences, really, into biology and natural sciences. So I studied that at university. I went on to do a master's as well, as you were saying, in natural sciences. And I worked for a while in that. But over the years, I found that I wasn't deeply enough interested in the subject, and I sort of went down the route of pharmaceuticals and that sort of thing. And it just didn't grab my interest over time. And then I was in India, I got married, and I had 2 daughters. And this was the time where I started thinking about things like the stories we tell our children. You know, I think as a parent, you are much more careful about the information that you give your children. You know, how do you contribute to the tapestry of their memories? This was something that really, concerned me. And there's this thing which I call the foundational story that we tell each other. We tell it at a national level sometimes about how our country has come about, what are the stories that go into making it. And even on a familial level, there'll be some elder person who will go on transmitting stories of this family, or this is our clan, we came from here, then we went there, we achieved these things. You know, there's always that sort of transmission of knowledge that happens, especially in the large families. And mine was a very small family. Like, I think a lot of the urban families nowadays are nuclear families. So you have lost, you are in a sense deracinated from these foundational stories that you often tell each other. And so I became more interested in the sort of story that I would tell my daughters. And so this was around the time that I started thinking about the epics. And I realized that around us, in our mythology, in our subconscious, our culture, our pop culture, the stories that are told to us are often the stories of mythological women. The historical women are forgotten. You know, they are obscured under layers of misinformation and disinterest, really. It's the mythological women who come to us in different forms and different guises and fed to us from a very young age. And so this was something that I was looking out for, and I noticed. And of course, the first person that comes to mind in this situation is Sita, because she is really often offered to us as an example of a perfect, Indian woman of wifely submission. And so this was something that bothered me, because while I might have accepted it for myself, I was not willing to accept this for my daughters. You know, so when we went to see the Ram Leela, you know, every year in the ballet troupe which performed it, the story always stopped at the stage where Sita comes back with Ram and they're all reunited, you know, in a happy family. But we know as adults that the story continues, that despite Sita being this perfect Pativra, this perfect example of wifely submission, she is still, her chastity is questioned and she is cast out. So this was something that troubled me, and this brought me to the idea of purity and impurity, pollution, and what is considered polluting. You know, things like even Kanya Puja that we do, you know, in various you know, societies in India, we are very happy to have this ritual where we worship young girls, and it's lovely to be part of it or to have your daughters chosen. But what are we really saying? We are saying that pre-pubertal girls are to be worshipped as goddesses, but the minute they start menstruating, they are impure. They are polluted. So, you know, what does this tell us for the journey of a woman going on? That, she, you know, she cannot perform certain rites when she is menstruating. She cannot do certain things. She's considered impure. So this idea of pollution, of pure versus impure, was something that really started, you know, taking up a lot of my attention. And I thought it would be an interesting way to view something which could be considered storytelling for, you know, young women in the 21st century. And so that brought me to my very first, in fact, Song of Draupadi is my very first manuscript.
Yeah. In fact, you know, it's interesting because, you know, this is the fourth book you've published, but this is the first book you wrote. And exactly. I think you were telling me that you wrote this 8 years back, yes. You know. I want to ask you, you know, Draupadi is perhaps the most colorful of figures. You know, she's got all the imperfections that you could think of. Yes. She stands her ground. I mean, she's a wonderful character in herself. What about her did you like the most that you actually went into it? And in Draupadi itself, there's so many renditions. If I'm not mistaken, there are 28 versions of the story of Draupadi alone. So how did you go about figuring out which one to pick out?
Yes, that's a really interesting question. And so Draupadi, I came to really almost as a reaction to Sita. I knew that I did not, even though Sita is a more complex character than she's, you know, in the way she's presented to us, Draupadi is almost the antithesis of Sita. So if we say this notion that I was, you know, talking about this idea of pollution, Draupadi almost co-opts this idea of pollution in the way I see her story. So when she is, for example, living her 13 years in exile, when she and her husbands are asked to leave Hastinapur and to live in exile, she has her hair open, she is ungroomed, because the humiliation that occurs to her initially in the sabha happens to her when she is menstruating, when she's in a polluted state. But she refuses to hide that. She, in fact, co-opts that, that idea of a woman who is polluted and decides that, to use it for her own purpose in seeking justice, in seeking retribution for herself. So during those 12 years and plus the 13th year as well in exile, she remains in front of her husband with her hair you know, open, which is a sign of an undomesticated woman, a feral woman almost in Indian society. You're meant to have your hair, you know, tied up and groomed. And she recalls this idea of blood, which is highly polluting when it's associated with women. And she tells her husband that I will not tie up my hair unless it is drenched in the blood of my enemy. So I found that such a powerful story, one that we need to recall and remember and maybe tell each other today. And that she uses this extremely sort of volatile image to channel her anger, because she is one of the rare women, I think, in mythology who really is able to express her anger. So that was one thing that was very clear in my mind. I did not want a woman who was meant to be quiet like Sita. I wanted a vocal, fiery, tempestuous, angry woman. And as for the idea of the many Mahabharats, as you know, the Mahabharata has been written and rewritten over hundreds of years. It was first told in oral form, and then it was written down over several. The scholars don't even agree on how many hundreds of years it took to finally come to the last you know, version of it, if you like. And then what we have is this huge rambling text of 75,000 verses, I think 18 books of it. And what happened in the early 20th century, in I think around 1933, the group of scholars in Pune in the Bhandarkar Oriental Research Institute decided to look at these Sanskrit texts and try to find the area where these stories overlapped so as to find a common origin story, if you like, one which was closest to the very earliest form of the Mahabharata. If you're talking about 600 years, more or less, give or take 100 years, over which the Mahabharata was written, they tried to find the earliest possible version. And they brought, over 40 years it took them looking at this text, and they brought out what is called the critical edition. Mm-hmm. So it is much shorter. It focuses on the action, if you like, on what happens. There is less of the poetry. There's less of the literary flourish. There's less philosophy as well, and less digression and less religion. So what you have, because I think what happened, what scholars have said has happened, is that after all, it was all written by Brahmin men. So when we talk about the voices of women, this is a sort of female ventriloquism. You know, this is not female voices. It is the way in which men think that females talk or think or act, right? So you will have a version where a woman will do something, and then you can see that later on, another pandit has come around and said, this thing that she is said to have done or said, like criticize her husband, it's really rather worrying, and I don't think it is relevant anymore. And so he put a long digression on the morality or philosophy of talking in this way, of how you should control your temper or not laugh too loudly. And it is really very, very amusing to see how these, but they leave the voices in there, and but they keep correcting or overcorrecting or adding little digressions. So the critical edition is what I look.
Right. You know, I must bring this, the visual, the Raja Ravi Varma painting that, of course, it's complete sacrilege to question Raja Ravi Varma. He's, you know, absolutely the god of art in India. But look at that image. I mean,
That's almost a submissive,
you know, woman who's lamenting at her fate.
Exactly.
And quite unlike what Draupadi would have been
unlike, you know, in that pose.
It then also reflects about on how people would like to see our heroines, right? You put them on a pedestal. You don't look at the colors, because she could have been wrong. I mean, the vengeance that she brought in, and that's the point that you make.
Yes.
That it was, you know, her ego being hurt, her vengeance, which brought about the war. Of course, you can justify it saying that it was meant to be, but in many senses, this painting and the picture that you present are two very, very...
very, very different. And in fact, I mean, far be it for me to criticize Raja Ravi Varma. That's not the point. But for me, this really does not exemplify Draupadi from the very start, from the fact that she's this fair woman here, you know, this Brahminical fair woman. And Draupadi was famously dark. You know, now we often forget it because the heroines who portray her in our popular culture now are so fair that we forget that she was celebrated for being dark. And in a country where we are, where people are, you know, brought into a state of self-loathing because of their dark skin, because they're told again and again they will not get a good marriage proposal, they will not get a job, they will not get a promotion if they are dark, and they spend their hard-earned money on you know, light skin lightening creams. We need to bring this back, and we need, this is part of her story, that she was famously dark, she was celebrated for being dark. Many of her names, her monikers, you know, are associated with the darkness of her skin, the blue lotus and Krishna and warm gold and all these lovely terms that are used. So she was celebrated dark woman. And she was not a victim. You know, I think it is important to remember this idea of her weeping, you know, quietly. We rarely hear of her weeping quietly. She's more raging, you know, raging against her husbands, raging about the men who insult her, whether it is Kichaka, the man who tried to assault her, Jayadratha, who tries to assault her. She never starts weeping like this. She pushes them away. She's very physical. So this idea of a victim, this fair, you know, upper caste Brahminical woman who is just crying quietly in the corner, really is very far away from the Draupadi that I imagine her to be.
Right. You know, in Live History India, we try to steer away from mythology only because it is so overarching. It's so interesting that it often subsumes any conversation on history. And I don't want to go down that path, because we must look at both women from legend and real figures from history. And you've done such good work on that. But I have to tell you that what stands out for me in the Mahabharata is that, of course, historically, we know it would have been an earlier text because it refers to an earlier period.
Yeah.
The Ramayana refers to a much later period. And the role of women is very interesting, because Draupadi might be a trailblazer, but she also sits along with fairly strong women who have, you know, held their own, so to say. So your book is actually not just looking at Draupadi, but at the whole caste, so to say.
That's right. In fact, you know, coming back to this whole notion that I had of pollution in women and purity and impurity, really, when I thought about it, what it comes down to is a deep concern and fear about the sexuality of women and how are men to control this fearful thing, which is a woman's sexuality, you know, within the marriage constraints, within the Lakshman Rekha that Sita has. These are the boundaries that a society puts on a woman's sexuality, that you can you are allowed your sexuality within the, you know, within the holy bounds of matrimony to produce sons. This is the single place in which you are allowed this. So men are deeply, deeply concerned about the control of the wombs of elite women. And this we see it very clearly in the Mahabharata, right from the time of Ganga, Satyavati, Kunti, Ambam, Balika. All these women, all the men around them are just really worried about how, you can see how the text is very worried and keeps writing and rewriting these episodes around them, wondering who controls their wombs. And these women within this incredibly patriarchal structure are still able to control their destiny to a certain extent. So whether it is Satyavati, this fisherwoman, without any power at all, any standing, who is forced to have a son out of wedlock before she is married, you know, by the Sadhu Durvasa, and she has this, her son Vyas, who is at that stage taken away from her. At that point, she is powerless. She has no control over her destiny. But later on, when she's queen of Hastinapur and she finds herself without heirs, her sons are unable to have heirs, she brings in this son from her earlier encounter and uses it to her advantage. So I found it very interesting how these women were nonetheless in a society which was really trying to constrain them and put so many strictures on their life and their you know, their liberties. They were still able to have some sort of agency even within that structure, and behind the scenes, if you like, controlled a lot of the action.